All right, we've previously looked at like what the bureaucracy is. It's just like all of the offices and departments and agencies that are part of the executive branch that kind of report to the president. So we kind of looked at that already, and we looked at sort of like some of the different elements of the bureaucracy. This is really going to focus on how the people within those government agencies get their jobs. There are 2.7 million people that work for the United States government. It's the largest single employer in the United States today, more than Amazon, more than Walmart. So the question is, like, how do the people within the bureaucracy get their jobs? And there was a way it used to be done, and there's like the current system. So for a small percentage of the people that work in the executive branch, like, they're appointed by the president, and then they have to be like approved or confirmed by the Senate. That would be your cabinet positions, like the directors of agencies like the FBI and the CIA. Like Miguel Cardona is Biden's nominee to be the Secretary of Education. So once Biden selects him, the Senate's going to have to approve him. But that's like the rare person that is nominated by the president and then needs Senate confirmation. Therefore, only a handful of like very specialized jobs. Besides the Secretary of Education that has to be appointed and then confirmed, there are thousands of just regular employees that work in the Department of Education that are not appointed by the president. And they don't have to be approved by Congress. They just, you know, applied for a job. And they don't change based on, you know, who the president is. 99.9% of those working in the executive branch are simply hired. They don't require Senate approval. And they don't know the president. They weren't personally selected by the president. They just filled out an application for a job and interviewed, like you and I would for a job. So that's how most of the jobs in the government are given out, is they're just regular jobs. Between 1789 and 1893, there was something called the spoils system. And the government jobs that existed were often given out by politicians that won elections as like a gratitude or a reward for people that helped get them elected, like people that worked on their campaigns, people that, worked hard to get votes for them, were then, when the person was elected, reward it with government jobs. You see the person, it's like an old cartoon from the 1800s, politician up on stage, that's like literally handing out like jobs, like their candy, right, to their supporters. And this was called patronage, or sometimes it was called the spoils system. The idea of like, to the victor go the spoils. The benefits go to those that win. And you would have these government officials from the president on down, like handing out government positions, not to the most qualified individuals, but to reward their supporters. This caused like major problems. Like, you don't need to necessarily know this guy's name, but as an example, like, this led to like major corruption and inefficiency. Like, you were putting people in government jobs that weren't really qualified to be there. So number one, like, they didn't really help the government, but then in extreme cases, they actually like used their position to like advance their own selfish motives. Like this guy on the screen, Samuel Swartlout, stole over $1 million after President Jackson's victory. And he named Swartwout, one of his supporters, as the tax collector for the Port of New York. Swartwout had no idea what he was doing and actually used his influence to essentially steal $1 million, right, from like the taxpayers. So like this kind of stuff happened like all over the place. So just the idea of the spoils system wasn't a very effective way to like govern. It led to corruption and all sorts of inefficiency. The turning point of this dispute over jobs really comes in 1880. James Garfield's elected president, and his attitude is enough's enough. He doesn't plan to reward supporters with government jobs. He wants to hire the most qualified people. So what ends up happening is one of the individuals that, you know, was one of his supporters that helped get Garfield elected, a guy named Charles Guiteau, after Garfield's election is like waiting for his like sort of cushy government job. And then Garfield announces that he's not going to do that. Guiteau is distraught. He's angry. He's frustrated. And he assassinates Garfield as a result. This is sort of like the turning point where people realize this has gotten to like an unmanageable point. And there's a law that's passed called the Pendelton Act. The Pendelton Act is a pretty like significant law in American history. It's passed in 1883 in the aftermath of the Garfield assassination. And it changes it so that most government jobs are given out on merit, largely based on exams or some other sort of like qualifications. And not necessarily who you know or connections or rewards, things like that. So this law requires that government jobs are distributed on like merit. And like I said, some like who deserves it. Not just, again, the connections you have. Some jobs they mentioned, like for example, like if you're a mail person, right? You're mail carrier every day, right? They actually had to take a civil service test, right? That like literally you could, you know, order a practice book from Amazon and study for the US postal test. And jobs are awarded based on how you perform on a, on the test. On the local level, police departments generally administer like a task, and based on how applicants do on the test is the order in which they're offered the job. This just prevents you from giving government jobs to people because of who they know or what connections they have, and again, tries to make it to the most deserving people. So again, this is sort of like a shift in how government jobs have been given throughout our country's history.